Good morning. This is Drew Danf, and I welcome you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to the broadcast of the Sunday morning worship service at St. Paul's Lutheran Church in California, Missouri. We are pleased to have you worship with us on this 19th Sunday after Pentecost, October 8th, 2023. The congregation prepares itself for worship as the organist, Twyla Duval, plays the prelude to the opening hymn. The procession with the cross carried by Adelina Kincaid has entered the nave of the church. The acolyte for today's worship service is Faith Ashley, who is lighting the candles in the chancel of the church. Pastor Kopper has entered the nave of the church with the procession. The broadcast of this worship service is underwritten by the English and Wickham families in celebration of the October 13th birthday of Marie Wickham. The bouquet of flowers gracing our altar this morning is provided by Wayne and Karen Hagemeyer in celebration of Abigail Christian's birthday, October 7th. Also, in blessed memory of Oscar Hagemeyer celebrating his birthday in heaven on October 10th. The opening hymn for today's worship service is The Church One Foundation, located on page 644 in the Lutheran Service Book. Following the opening hymn, Pastor Kopper will lead the congregation in today's worship service number one, beginning on page 151. Our worship bulletins can be found on our church website at www.stpaulslutheran1860.com under the bulletin board menu. To begin today's service, Pastor will offer the invocation followed by the confession and absolution. He will then lead us in the responsive reading of the psalm, Psalm 80, verse 7, 14 through 15, and 17 and 18. Following this, the congregation joins in singing the Kyrie on page 152 in the Lutheran Service Book. This is the Feast on page 155 in the Lutheran Service Book, and the Salutation and Collect on page 156 in the Lutheran Service Book.
Good morning. Welcome to St. Paul's Lutheran Church. All of you who are here with us this morning, especially those who are visiting. The 19th Sunday after Pentecost is we are celebrating today with great joy and with a lot of love for our Lord and Savior Jesus. We sing and praise Him today. We also welcome those who are following us on Facebook. May God bless us all. And then if you can stand, please do it so we can start the service today. Just to remind you all that we are following the divine service setting one this weekend or this Sunday. We start today then in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Let us then confess our sins to God, our Father. Dear congregation, Almighty God in His mercy has given His Son to die for you and for His sakes. Forgives all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by His authority, I therefore forgive all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The first reading for the 19th Sunday after Pentecost comes from the Psalm 32. Restore us, God Almighty. Make your face shine on us that we may be saved.
Return to us, God Almighty. Look down from heaven
and see.
Watch over this
line.
The root of your right hand
is righted. The Son you have raised up for yourself. Let your hand rest on the man at your right hand, the Son of Man you have raised up for yourself. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Christ the Lamb who was slain, whose blood set us free to
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Merciful Father, in your abundant love, you redeem us from our sin and restore us as your own children in Christ. As you have crowned us with love and mercy, keep us in this grace and favor that we may strive to complete the race and receive from your hand the crown of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, O Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Today's elders, Rick Sedwick and Scott Volkart, will now approach the lectern to lead us in the Old Testament reading from Isaiah chapter 5, verses 1 through 7, and the epistle reading from Philippians chapter 3, verses 4b through 14. Pastor Kopper will then lead the congregation in the reading of the Holy Gospel from St. Matthew chapter 21, verses 33 through 46.
Good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone today and extend a welcome to our listeners on KRLL Radio. Today's Old Testament reading is Isaiah chapter 5, the first 7 verses. I will sing for the one I love a song about his vineyard. My loved one had a vineyard on a fertile hillside. He dug it up and cleared it of stones and planted it with the choicest vines. He built a watchtower in it and cut out a wine press as well. Then he looked for a crop of good grapes, but it yielded only bad fruit. Now you dwellers in Jerusalem and people of Judea, judge between me and my vineyard. What more could have been done for my vineyard that I have not done for it? When I looked for good grapes, why did it yield only bad? Now I will tell you what I am going to do to my vineyard. I will take away its hedge, and it will be destroyed. I will break down its wall, and it will be trampled. I will make it a wasteland, neither pruned nor cultivated, and briars and thorns will grow there. I will command the clouds not to rain on it. The vineyard of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle reading is Philippians 3, verses 4b through 14. If someone else thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee, as for zeal persecuting the church, as for righteousness based on the law, faultless. But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so, somehow, attaining to the resurrection from the dead. Now that I have already obtained all of this, or have already arrived at my goal, I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
If you can, please stand for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the chapter 21, verses 33 to 46. Listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard. He put a wall around it and dug a wine press, and it built a watchtower. Then he rented the vineyard to some farmers and moved to another place. When the harvest time approached, he sent his servants to the tenants to collect his fruit. The tenants seized his servants. They beat one, killed another, and stoned a third. Then he sent other servants to them, more than the first time, and the tenants treated them the same way. Last of all, he sent his son to them. They will respect my son, he said. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to each other, this is the heir. Come, let's kill him and take his inheritance. So they took him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. Therefore, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? He will bring those wretches to a wretched end, they replied, and he will rent the vineyard to other tenants who will give him his share of the crop at harvest time. Jesus said to them, have you never read the scriptures? The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore, I will tell you that the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people who will produce its fruit. Anyone who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces. Anyone on whom it falls will be crushed. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard Jesus' parables, they knew he was talking about them. They looked for a way to arrest him, but they were afraid of the crowd because the people held that he was a prophet. This is the word of God. With all the Christians in the world, let us confess our faith with the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. The third day he rose again according to the scriptures and ascended to heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remissions of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Congregation may be seated.
As Pastor prepares to deliver his sermon, the congregation will join in singing hymn 664, Fight the Good Fight.
Thank you.
the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Two parables of Jesus being told the last 2 weeks. When we start reading the gospel, we see that Jesus is saying this is the second parable. And Jesus said, and now he is telling us another parable. At this time, it's about the kingdom of God. And this time is about God who planted a vineyard and rented out to tenants. The parable is based in Isaiah, or on Isaiah chapter 5, and we cannot be surprised with this because Isaiah is like a fifth gospel right in the middle of the Old Testament. Isaiah is the prophet that foretells the people what is going to happen and how God is going to treat them when they go to God, when they worship God. Isaiah proclaims the good news of the restoration and freedom, those two beautiful words, meaningful words for the people in captivity. And now Isaiah is prophesizing what Jesus is saying. Or maybe Jesus is quoting the Bible, because Jesus knew the Bible very well, as we all should know. So Jesus is telling or retelling what Isaiah said 700-800 years before. I will sing for the one I love a song about his vineyard. My loved one had a vineyard on a fertile hillside. This is God that has a fertile vineyard. His people, Israel, he planted in paradise. He gave it to them to be happy, to live a blessed life in paradise. Then he looked for a crop of good grapes, but it yielded only bad fruit. His people turned to other gods, to the gods of the Canaanites, to Baal, to a god made of bronze and iron. And so God has to send his people to captivity. And God did. And now they are in captivity, crying out to God, Lord, have mercy on us. And then Isaiah comes with the word of the gospel. And that's why we call Isaiah the gospel in the Old Testament. And it says, if you turn to God and if you repent, then you will be reestablished as a nation and you'll be blessed again. Those words Jesus takes from the Old Testament. And he replies to the Sadducees and Pharisees because they are not happy with Christ. But this parable is also a reminder of what God had done to the people when God took them out of captivity in Egypt and planted them in that rich land of milk and honey. A land that when you travel through, you see only sand and stones. You think of yourself, I don't know how this land can be a land that produces, and it is fertile, it is rich in land, milk, and honey. You cannot believe that. But it's only upon God's promise and God's love for his people that the land becomes good, productive. And it was upon God's promise that the people never starved, but always had everything they needed. So God said, I planted a vineyard. I gave to my people. I expect fruits. But none came. When God gave the vineyard to the people, he wants fruits, but in return, he got nothing. God only wants the people to return to him in praises, return to him with thankful hearts. Return to him bearing fruits, which means loving God and loving neighbor. But they could not do that. So God in his mercy and his love to remind his people of what they should do and how they should act, he starts sending prophets, many of them. Listen to the words of the Bible. Count how many prophets are in the Bible. Just think of yourself very quick. Take a moment. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Jonah, so many prophets. And some of the prophets were killed, some were stoned, like Stephen. They didn't listen to God. Finally, God and his ultimate mercy and his love and his compassion for his people, he sent Jesus Christ to the vineyard. And then they killed the Son of Man. And Jesus tells with details, they drag him out of the vineyard to kill him. And the Apostle Paul tells us in Hebrews chapter 13, Jesus was crucified outside of the gate, just so the prophecy would be kind of right. This is the story of the people of Israel. And Jesus is retelling to the Sadducees and Pharisees. Jesus said, I am the cornerstone. The stone the builders rejected, Jesus Christ, has become the capstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. He who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, but he on whom it falls will be crushed. You see, in Jesus' day, the cornerstone and capstone were the two most important because they were the first and the last stone installed in a building. The cornerstone was larger than the other stones because it was the starting point from what everything would be built upon. So every other stone was perfectly aligned and built upon that big stone. And the capstone was often the very last stone installed on the building. If all the stones didn't align from the cornerstone to the capstone as was expected, the structure would be ruined. So a good builder never let this happen. God in his mercy and his love sent the cornerstone to be the basis of anybody else, everyone's lives in this world. God is building his plan for you and for me, my brother and sister. Jesus Christ, who is the beginning and the end, he was in the beginning creating the world with God the Father. He was also promised to be our Savior right thereafter. Man fell in sin. He is the cornerstone, and upon him only our faith should lie. Jesus is present in every prophecy of the Old Testament. Read carefully and you will see. He was incarnate by the Virgin Mary. He became man. He was crucified. He performed miracles. He loved you. He loves me. He died on the cross for us. He is the cornerstone that cannot be rejected. So we ask ourselves today a simple question. Am I building my life aligned with Christ? Our cornerstone. If not, Jesus says, this cornerstone breaks and crushes those on whom it falls. So what does this mean? Let's make things more practical now. I know sometimes the Gospels, they follow a sequence, and every once in a while we see one or two stories that break that sequence that we have. Now, you might be surprised with this, but the words Jesus said in this parable were told were spoken by Jesus on Sunday. I'm sorry, it was Tuesday after he ride into Jerusalem for the Palm Sunday. So Jesus had ridden into Jerusalem, amidst the shouts of Hosanna to the Son of God. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And then on Monday, he had cleansed the temple. And he was saying to the Pharisees and to the leaders of his time, "My house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making a den of robbers." So they were totally in disagreement with Jesus. And then, since then, they try to kill him. And then this parable also aligns with the last parable, the parable from last weekend. As we read and heard last weekend, the chief priests and Pharisees, the elders of the people, challenged Jesus, saying, "By what authority have you been doing these things? And who gave you this authority?" Jesus said then, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and understanding and revealed them to the little children." So now it's when it comes the second part of the parable. Because they reject Jesus, Jesus took the vineyard from his people and gave to the Gentiles. And we are the Gentiles to whom Christ, God, gave the vineyard. So now it's our turn to take care of the vineyard God gave us. The vineyard now belongs to everyone who believes in God, who trusts in him as the cornerstone. The vineyard belongs to me and to you, and we are called to bear fruit. Because God in his grace sent his Son, and this is what we call the time of grace. The time when we are all invited to produce fruits to his vineyard. As simple as it can be. And then my question and my invitation to you today is, first of all, do you have Jesus Christ as your cornerstone? Do you base your decisions, your life upon that rock? Think about it. Jesus said, "I took those things from the wise because the wise believe they can do everything themselves. And the philosophy of this world, the wisdom of this world, preaches that we don't need God anymore. That God is a fantasy. The Bible is not right. There are some parts of the Bible that might be truth, but most of all is just baloney." And a lot of people believe in that. Today, God is calling us to set our hearts and minds into the cornerstone that is Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. The world might tell us different. But as we know the Bible, as we read the Bible, we'll understand that God is calling us to be good tenants of this vineyard. It was in Numbers chapter 20 when God said, "Moses, go and strike that rock." People were complaining in the desert because they had no water to drink. And so God says first, "Moses, go and talk with the rock." But Moses didn't think about talking. He was a little, I guess, stressed out with his people. I would be. He was leading 300,000 plus children and women from Egypt to the Holy Land. So instead of talking with the rock, Moses went there and just struck the rock. But the water came out. And all the people had water to drink. Many, many years later, the Apostle Paul, a profound reader, in his wisdom and his thirst for the Word of God, he writes, "For I do not want you to be ignorant of the fact, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud and that they all passed through the sea. They were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. They all ate the same spiritual food and drank the same spiritual drink. For they drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them. And that rock was Christ. The rock that Moses struck in the Old Testament. It was a foreshadow of the rock that was struck on the cross 900 years later. And from that rock in the Old Testament came water to help people and to so people could survive. Jesus, the rock, the cornerstone, was struck on the cross, so we, by the blood, by his blood, can survive in this world and have fellowship with God, forgiveness of sins, and can have our lives restored as his blood comes out of this, of him, the rock of salvation. If you do not believe in that, when people don't believe in that, that stone will crush them. But by the mercy and love of God, we all had the opportunity to believe through baptism and communion and word. That rock is not going to struck us. It will save us. Not because we deserve, no, because God in his love and his mercy gave it to us. Isaiah also, I was reading this morning Isaiah in my devotion. Isaiah chapter 65 verse 1. God said to the prophet, "I revealed myself to those who did not ask for me, and I was found by those who do not seek me." Do you see the mercy and the love of God in these words? You didn't ask for salvation, but God gave it to you. You did not ask for life everlasting, but God in his mercy gave it to you. So be a good tenant and continue spreading the love of our Lord and Savior Jesus. Amen.
The ushers will now come forward to receive the offering plates as the congregation joins in singing just sang the offertory on page 159 in the Lutheran service book. We invite you to listen to the worldwide message of the Lutheran Hour, broadcast on station KRLL at 7:30 a.m. each Sunday. Today's Lutheran Hour was sponsored by the English and Wickham families. Each weekday morning at 6:15 a.m., the California Ministerial Alliance conducts a 5-minute devotional program on KRLL. We invite you to begin your day with these messages. This week's messages are offered by Reverend Russell Cobb of the United Church of Christ of California, Missouri. We are happy to provide these broadcasts to you, but they are costly. We may not be able to continue broadcasting without listener donations. If you value our broadcast and would care to help support them, you may send your donation to St. Paul's Lutheran Church, 207 North Owen Street, California, Missouri, 65018. We greatly appreciate your support in helping us continue these broadcasts. Following the offering, Pastor Kopper will lead the church in the prayers of the day, followed by the service of the sacrament, beginning on page 160 of the hymnal with the preface. Then the servicing elders will prepare the elements of bread and wine to the saints so they may be nourished with the Lord's Supper.
Let us pray. O Lord, you have planted, nurtured, and hedged around your vineyard, the church. Inspire her by your Holy Spirit to yield much fruit for your kingdom, and grant that many find shelter on her holy hill. Lord, in your mercy. Divine vine dresser, you bring from this barren earth a holy people to press forward. Direct our zeal towards your good purpose, and prosper the work of the hands that labor in your name. Subject for his sake to the fleeting powers of this world, that we may live and continue good godliness and peace that passes all understanding. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful Lord, with compassion, look with compassion upon those who are struggling with illness, grief, or any malady, especially those in our hearts and prayers. Connie Bervinger, Darlene Blythe, Fred Blythe, Gina Foster, June Friedmeier, Marie Gensch, Larry Gish, Joe Green, Karen Hagemeyer, Janice Howard, Chris Youngmeyer, Joyce Kiesling, Jerry Kisu, Kyle Kister, Lucas Manley, Norma Jean Martin, Brad O'Neill, David Opel, Diane Regan, Dakota Reed, Michael Rex, Larry Schenberg, Eileen Sheriff, Patty Swatzel, Sandy Taylor, John Turner, Bob Winkler, and Dolores Woods. We also remember those who are homebound in our care facilities. We pray, O Lord, for Mary Ann Clinton, Clarice Alexander, Ralph Dudley, Marie Gensch, Iris Hack, Ruth Higgins, June Kister, Ruth Meyer, and Dorothy Stubinger. We ask that they may also have confidence in the power of his resurrection. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, your blessings are renewed every day. Your compassion and love allow us to live in this world enjoying every single day you have given to us. We pray for Marie Wickman and Abigail Christian on this day as they are celebrating their birthdays this month. Bless their lives today and all the days that follow. Oh, gracious God, Heavenly Father, we lift before you the country of Israel. We ask you, Lord, to protect and guard Israel against terrorism and the evil of terrorism and against all its enemies. Be with its people, especially those who are suffering amid the recent conflict and war. Kindle, we pray, in the hearts of all the true love of peace and guide with your pure and peaceable wisdom, those who take counsel for the nations of the earth, that in tranquility your kingdom may go forward till the earth is filled with the knowledge of your love. Bless all of us, O Lord, who comes to the Lord's Supper today to receive your body and blood in this holy supper. Strengthen us in faith and renew us in love by this holy communion. Bring us at last with all the saints to dwell in your everlasting presence. Lord, in your mercy. I'll ask the congregation please to stand so we can all together just start preparing our hearts and minds to receive the body and blood of Jesus. We open on the page 160. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. The congregation of Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take and eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as you drink this bread, eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
You are listening to the Divine Worship Service from St. Paul's Lutheran Church in California, Missouri. It has been our pleasure to have you worship with the members of St. Paul's through the facilities of KRLL. May God's holy angels watch over you and your loved ones, and we hope you'll join us again next Sunday. Your radio announcer has been Drew Damp. Your live stream director has been Jason Youngmeyer.
Receive this wonderful. is the true blood of Christ, our Lord and Savior. It is given to you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Take and drink the true blood of Christ, our Lord and Savior, shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Take and drink the true blood of Christ, our Lord and Savior, shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Take and drink. Amen. As you all receive the body and blood of Jesus Christ in our Lord, peace, and the good Lord will be with you always. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, peace. Thank you.
You all receive the blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Yes, it's me again. One more time. Good morning, everyone. On your bulletin, there's a lot of things on the back of the bulletin. First one I'm a little jealous of, and it's next Sunday is Hat Day. And it's for the ladies and the girls, not for the guys. Sorry about that. Anyway, please wear a hat in observance of our 40th anniversary celebration. Also, I'd like to announce that there's a new Bible class today, a Sunday school class. Kyle Freiner will be beginning a Bible class for 3rd, 4th, 5th, and 6th grade. So please make sure that happens. Also, I would like Pastor, not that he doesn't get enough exercise, but like I'd like him to come back up to the front. While he's coming up, I want to say that we're going to have a voters meeting right after dismissal. So leave, come back, and we'll have our voters meeting. Also, we need a really accurate count of how many are going to be here next Sunday for the meal. And it's for everybody in the congregation, Wendell. It's for everyone, not just those that were confirmed, married, baptized, whatever here. But we'd like everybody who can to come. It's a potluck, but we kind of need to have a good indication of how many people are going to be here so we get enough chicken and ham, all right, and have enough places set up downstairs. So the sign-up sheet is over there. We have between 90 and 100 right now. So if you're coming and haven't signed up, please sign up. If you know someone who is coming and hasn't signed up, sign up for them, okay? Thank you very much. Pastor, I have something here for you. I'm going to read it. It says, "Thank you for your special ministry. God has blessed you with gifts that are making a difference. Wisdom in the truth you share, compassion in your encouragement, love in your caring and comfort. Genesis 12:2, I will bless you and you will be a blessing to others. Thank you for the way you have used the special gifts of God that God has given you to bless and minister to others. We appreciate you, St. Paul's congregation, and there's a small token of our appreciation, Pastor.
Thank you very much, Dave. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
I know I talk a lot today, but I just want to say thank you very much. My family and I, we love this congregation, and we are honored to be your pastor. Thank you.